Good evening and welcome to the news tonight. 30 minutes of non-stop updates on your day's top national and international stories. I'm Tracy Shilshi and here are the headlines. War of words between the JDU and the BJP. Being denied a special assembly session to prove majority, Nitish Kumar now blames the centre for scripting the political crisis in Bihar. Delhi's Chief Minister-designate Arvind Kejriwal takes up the statehood issue with Prime Minister Modi. Aam Aadmi Party gets ready for ministerial portfolios and the swearing-in on Saturday. After its decimation in Delhi, blame game begins in the Congress. Former Chief Minister Sheila Dixit accuses Ajay Makan of leading a confused election campaign. Inflation figures inch upwards for January. Industrial production falls drastically, though, in December. And grand opening ceremonies for the Cricket World Cup held in Melbourne and Christchurch. 14 teams are participating in the event. The first matches take place on Saturday. The big story, the BJP and the JDU traded charges over the political crisis in Bihar. The BJP strongly refuted JDU leader Nitish Kumar's remarks, accusing the Modi government of encouraging political horse trading in Bihar. Supporters of the Chief Minister Jitin Ram Manjhi, on the other hand, are confident that he will be able to prove his majority on the 20th of February when the state budget session starts.
A day after making his party's case with the president, former Chief Minister Nitish Kumar on Thursday targeted the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, alleging that the Bihar governor was following a political script written by him in Delhi, all with a view to facilitate horse trading in the state.
JDU ke president ne direction diya ki aap hata diye gaye hain, resign kar diye, nahi resign kiya, party se nikal diya gaya. He becomes unattached member under 10th schedule. तो क्या मतलब है जेडीयू से? जेडीयू जो आज की सरकार जिसको बीजेपी के इशारे पर प्रोलोंग रखने की कोशिश हो रही है.
On Wednesday, the governor told incumbent Chief Minister Jitin Ram Manjhi to prove his majority on the floor of the House on 20th of February, rejecting Nitish Kumar's request for the trial of strength to be taken immediately.
जाते जाते हम आप लोगों की व्यवस्था करके जाएंगे और यदि रहने की बारी आ जाएगी तो फिर आप सोच सकते हैं कि आपके लिए और क्या न किया जा सकता है.
The budget session will start in Bihar from 20th of February. Manjhi has been asked to prove majority on the same day after the governor's address. Nitish Kumar claims it will be a bizarre situation since the governor will read out an address prepared by a chief minister who has support of only 12 MLAs.
Shri Nitish Kumar ji ne sarvajanik roop se bahut hi bebuniyad, झूठे और प्रायोजित आरोप लगाए हैं भाजपा के खिलाफ. उन्होंने कोई नेता का नाम नहीं लिया है, लेकिन इशारों में भी प्रधानमंत्री और अमित शाह की आलोचना की है. हम पार्टी की ओर से उनकी टिप्पणियों को बिल्कुल नकारते हैं.
हमेशा से जो साथी उनके साथ रहते हैं, चाहे वो उनके साथ लालू यादव जी रहे हों, चाहे रामविलास पासवान जी रहे हों, सबके दलों को उन्होंने तोड़ा है. भारतीय जनता पार्टी के साथ उन्होंने जनता का विश्वास हासिल किया, फिर भारतीय जनता पार्टी को भी उन्होंने धोखा दिया है. तो उनका इतिहास, उनका कार्य करने की पद्धति इस प्रकार की है.
In a setback to Nitish Kumar's claims, the Patna High Court on Wednesday stayed his election as JDU legislature party leader.
कल का उनका आदेश का किसी प्रकार का प्रभाव राजनीतिक पार्टी इंक्लूडिंग जेडीयू के मामले पर नहीं पड़ेगा, अर्थात श्री नीतीश कुमार के नेता चुने जाने पर इस आदेश का कोई प्रभाव नहीं पड़ेगा और न कोई विवाद है.
Nitish Kumar brought about 130 MLAs to Delhi when he met President Pranab Mukherjee on Wednesday. Leaders of JDU allies RJD, Congress, Samajwadi Party and the left accompanied him during the meeting. JDU leaders claim the BJP has asked Manjhi to get the support of about 35 MLAs. With Shyam Sundar, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, back to Delhi, and preparations are on for the swearing-in ceremony of Arvind Kejriwal on the 14th of February. He has invited all union ministers, but Prime Minister Modi will miss it owing to previous engagements. The two leaders, though, met earlier today, and Kejriwal brought back the demand for Delhi statehood. Here are the details.
An eagerly watched 15-minute chai pe charcha between the Prime Minister and the man who nearly managed to wipe the BJP slate clean in the Delhi Assembly. The Prime Minister, however, turned down the swearing-in invite, citing prior engagements. Even at his first meeting, Kejriwal brought up the issue of full statehood for Delhi, reportedly calling the move a golden opportunity with a majority government now in place.
हमने उनसे रिक्वेस्ट किया कि ये दोनों पूर्ण बहुमत वाली सरकारों को मिलके अब दिल्ली की एक बहुत बड़ा इशू जो पूर्ण राज्य का मुद्दा है वो सॉल्व करना चाहिए और दिल्ली के लोगों को एक पूर्ण राज्य का दर्जा देकर उनको पूरी सुविधाएं मिल सकें ऐसी व्यवस्था हमको मिलकर बनानी चाहिए प्रधानमंत्री जी ने इस बारे में हमें भरोसा दिया है कि वो इस पर पूरा विचार करेंगे
The centre's support will be critical for Kejriwal to fulfill many of his mega promises, and separate statehood is seen as the most difficult of them all. The BJP spokesperson says the centre will be willing to take up the age-old issue with the new Delhi government.
This issue of statehood has been pending for several decades. So I think there are a lot of issues to be discussed and resolved. Let the state government first be constituted and then let them make their own proposals, which can be discussed with the central government.
For the oath-taking ceremony at the Ramlila Maidan on Saturday, Aam Aadmi Party has also invited all union cabinet ministers, the BJP's 7 Delhi MPs and Kiran Bedi. Elaborate preparations are underway for the event that will coincide with the day Kejriwal quit office exactly a year ago.
Shapath samaroh mein aam public bhi aayegi. चूंकि आम पब्लिक का नंबर काफ़ी ज़्यादा होगा तो इसलिए हमने जो मुनासिब इंतज़ाम किए हैं उसमें सुरक्षा के भी रहेंगे क्राउड कंट्रोल के भी रहेंगे ट्रैफिक का इंतज़ाम होगा लोकल पुलिस का इंतज़ाम होगा सिक्योरिटी का इंतज़ाम होगा पीसीआर की गाड़ियां रहेंगी
In the backdrop of the resounding victory, speculation also gathers steam on the constitution of Kejriwal's cabinet. Kejriwal's close aide Manish Sisodia is reportedly set to be named Deputy Chief Minister. Not just in Delhi, around the country, Arvind Kejriwal is the man of the moment. His every move will be closely watched. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha Television.
Meanwhile, 2 days after the total rout in the Delhi Assembly elections, a blame game is raging in the Congress. Sheila Dixit, who led the party's government in Delhi for 15 years, is now questioning the party's campaign strategy, and Ajay Makan, the man who led it.
कैंपेन उनकी लीडरशिप में वो तो कैंपेन कमेटी के चेयरमैन थे तो उनको बहुत अग्रेसिवली करना चाहिए था अगर जो क्रिटिसिज्म अग्रेसिव हो सकता है तो अपने बारे में जो अच्छाइयां हैं उनको उसको भी तो अग्रेसिव होना चाहिए ना कुछ हमारी स्ट्रेटजी में बहुत कमजोरियां रह गई और यही कारण रहा कि हम इतनी ऐसी हालत पर पहुंचे
टू डेज आफ्टर इट्स डेसिमेशन इन दिल्ली वॉइसेस ऑफ डिसेंट आर इंक्रीजिंग इन द कांग्रेस Leading the charge is Sheila Dixit herself.
चुनाव लड़ रहे हैं लेकिन विदाउट अ स्ट्रेटजी विदाउट कलेक्टिव लीडरशिप अजय माकन जी के बारे में मैं क्या टिप्पणी करूं एक्सेप्ट के बजे पूरा आई जस्ट पिटी हिम
पीसी चाको द मैन इन चार्ज ऑफ द दिल्ली इलेक्शंस फॉर कांग्रेस रिजेक्ट द एलिगेशंस लेवल बाय दीक्षित
नॉट ओनली कांग्रेस पार्टी इंक्लूडिंग बीजेपी एंड अदर पार्टीज एंड ऑल द पॉलिटिकल पंडित्स देयर ऑल द कैलकुलेशंस वेंट रॉन्ग एंड इट वाज अ very rare kind of phenomena which happened in Delhi. But how to rebuild the party, Congress party, is everybody's responsibility. That cannot be done by apportioning the blame each other.
The Delhi debacle was the fifth assembly election defeat in a row for the Congress since the Lok Sabha polls last May. But more importantly, the party saw its vote share eroded from 24.55% in 2013 to 9.7% this time. The question now is where does the Congress go from here? Vishal Daya's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Yes, that is the big question. Where does the Congress go from here? We've got senior journalist Saroj Nagi joining us this evening from the capital. Saroj, thanks so much for joining us here. Yes, like we were saying, the big question, where does the Congress go from here? And at this point of time, with somebody, as Sheila Dixit, who has been in charge of Delhi for 15 years, now coming out and saying that she was completely sidelined and you know the blame totally lied on the Congress party management and also Ajay Makan.
Yes, you know, I'd be surprised if there was no blame game after the defeat. Each time there is a defeat, the blame game always starts between the Congress leadership about who is responsible for it. Now, the very peculiar thing in the Congress is that if it wins, it gives the credit to the Congress leadership, which essentially means Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi. But when it comes to defeat, the lower rung of leaders, the second ranking leaders, they start blaming each other. Now, Delhi, they got a duck in Delhi. And it wasn't really unexpected. I think I would have been surprised, or most people would have been surprised, if they had got even two seats in Delhi. Although there was speculation and exit polls were giving out a larger number than that also sometimes. But the point is that in Delhi they got a duck, and yes, this is again another duck after the series of ducks they got in the Lok Sabha elections. If I remember correctly, there were almost 19 states and union territories where the Congress could not open its account. So in Delhi you have a person, you can blame Ajay Makan for it, you know, at a time when the Congress's fortunes have really gone downhill, and you have a person as the head of the campaign when the party is in the dumps. So blaming merely Ajay Makan for it, I think, is slightly misplaced. After all, Sheila Dixit herself had lost the elections. Yeah. I'm not exonerating Ajay Makan or Sheila Dixit or anybody else, but the basic flaw lies with the Congress senior leadership, the top leadership, because after what happened in the Lok Sabha elections, what has the Congress done? Where does the Congress, you ask the question, where does the Congress go from here?
Yeah.
Now, for 9 months after the Lok Sabha elections, neither Sonia Gandhi nor Rahul Gandhi have done really anything. They had a committee which went to the reasons for the losses, and the only thing that the committee did was to absolve Rahul Gandhi of all blame for spearheading a campaign in which the Congress got only 44 seats. But we are talking only about the post-Lok Sabha elections where the Congress has done badly. Before the Lok Sabha elections also, there was a series of assembly election defeats which were, and these defeats were the ones in which Rahul had led the campaign.
Yes.
So what does Rahul get for
Where is he now?
Each time,
you know,
there is a defeat. Where is he now?
Exactly. Where is he now? I mean, because Ajay Makan was leading the campaign, absolutely fine. He has to take the blame. He took the blame. He's gone now. He's resigned. But then, you know, you had these elaborate roadshows that Rahul Gandhi had also done. So why isn't anybody questioning him? And where is he now? Why isn't he coming out to even say anything?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, Ajay Makan's is one defeat in Delhi. Rahul Gandhi's is a series of red lines in his report card. Even before the Lok Sabha elections, they lost a series of assembly elections, including Delhi. So, I mean, why doesn't anybody question that? Elections, winning and losing are part of the game. I'm not going into that.
Yes.
But the point is, if you've lost an election, you should do something to tell your cadres that you're trying to revive the party. But after the elections, he really vanishes from the scene. And each time he fails, he's rewarded with a greater post.
Absolutely.
You know, after the series of assembly election debacles, he was elevated as vice president of the party. And now the presidential elections are coming up, and there is a fear among congressmen that he would be main president. After all, Sonia Gandhi is getting on in age, and she's not really keeping too well. Off and on, she visits the hospitals. So now Sonia wants to pass on the mantle to Rahul, and Rahul is not showing any kind of initiative to take the party out of the dumps. He does talk about broad-basing and democratizing the youth Congress, but the point is, the kind of experiment he is conducting with the frontal organizations hasn't really paid off. In fact, it's been an abject failure. If you talk to Congress people privately, they have a different story to tell. And now the scene has come to such an extent that each time there is a defeat, there are loud cries of bringing in Priyanka Gandhi.
Yes.
The workers want somebody who can lead them, inspire them.
Yes, I mean, where is any kind of motivation for the party workers? Exactly. I mean, what is your saving grace? Like, even in Assam today, the civic polls, landslide victory to the BJP. Congress, of course, held on to Assam for so long. But even there, next year, of course, the Assam assembly polls take place. But the civic body, as far as it's concerned, the BJP is, you know, totally in control there. What is the saving grace? Where is the motivation really for the party workers? Is this perhaps the worse that you've seen the Congress really slumped down to?
Yeah, I think it's really, it's hurtling down a chasm and an abyss or whatever you call it, and there's no sign of redemption at the moment. And talking about Priyanka at this point of time, also I want to make the point that Priyanka remains an untested commodity, and whatever little she had to do was confined only to Rai Bareli and Amethi for the Lok Sabha polls. But if you look at the assembly elections in these two constituencies, she promised her mother she would get all 10 seats in the assembly polls, and all she managed to get was 2 seats for the party.
Yes.
So she has, and then she carries the baggage of Vadra on her shoulders if she's brought in.
Yes.
So I don't think that, I'd like to make another point, because the Gandhis seem to have lost their charisma where the people are concerned.
Yes.
And where the workers have only the Gandhis to look up to it. They know that if they bring another person as a party president, if the Congress has collapsed under the Gandhis, it would be decimated without the Gandhis.
Absolutely.
Because
absolutely,
all said and done,
really
the Gandhis remain a cementing force, no matter, even if the cement has lost out on its life.
Yes.
So all that right. is the bottom line at the moment.
Absolutely.
And
Saroj Nagi, I'm sorry, we're running
really
short of time, but thanks so much, Saroj Nagi, joining us and giving us a perspective really on the way the Congress is looking at the moment and what lies ahead. We just hope, you know, something does emerge, at least for the Congress workers, some kind of motivation for them. We'll keep an eye, of course, on that. But still ahead, after the break, we've got U.S. President Barack Obama asking, in fact, Congress for special troops against the Islamic State. More on that in just a bit.
Bihar in the thick of fresh political turmoil. Who's responsible? What will come out of it? Watch The Big Picture at 6:30 p.m. and 9:30 p.m. on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. You're watching the news tonight. All right, some business news now. And inflation for January inched up to 5.11% compared to 4.28% in December. The new inflation figures were calculated by the Central Statistical Organization by changing the CPI base year from 2009-10 to 2011-12. It also attached more weight for services like education and health and broadened the item basket. Food inflation stood at 6.13%, fuel at 3.74%, and clothing and footwear at 6.15%. The index of industrial production for the month of December slowed down to 1.7% as against 3.8% in the previous month. Manufacturing and electricity grew at 2.1% and 4.8%, while mining recorded a negative 3.2% growth. Well, all these numbers crucial with just weeks to go for the annual budget. And Finance Minister Arun Jaitley has assured that the pace of economic reforms will not be affected by the BJP's defeat in the Delhi Assembly elections. Jaitley, in fact, said this today after the fifth meeting of the Indo-US Economic and Financial Partnership in New Delhi. US Treasury Secretary Jacob Lowe, in fact, represented the US at this meeting. These were the finance minister's first comments after the BJP's loss in Delhi, and they have come in the backdrop of experts raising questions on whether the government would resort to populism in the wake of electoral reverse. Jaitley is scheduled to present his first full budget for 2015-16 on the 28th of February.
The fact that four elections have been won and one has not been won is absolutely no ground for believing that there would be any slow down on the path on which we have undertaken.
Well, the budget this year holds special interest, expected as it is to give tangible shape to the Modi government's plans and promises that it made since taking over. One of the chief focus for investors and business in general is the government's pet scheme, the Make in India program. In the first installment of our special series on budget expectations starting today, we are taking a look at what the industry dealing with key sectors under the Make in India mission want and what the finance minister is likely to give them.
मैं आज लाल किले की प्राचीर से विश्व भर में लोगों से कहना चाहता हूं, कम मेक इन इंडिया.
4 months after the Prime Minister's Independence Day announcement last year, the government held its first Make in India workshop in Delhi to spell out plans to help industry make, sell and invest in India.
Our initial barriers have to be lowered and perhaps even removed. If we keep the doors closed, investment won't come in, it won't trickle in.
When he presents his second budget on 28th of February, Jaitley is expected to announce steps to make business barrier-free. The industry is hoping a low tax regime will be one of them.
Operation, the investment will not be coming. The investment will have to be coming only when there is a demand in the country, and unfortunately at the moment there is no demand in the country.
In January, the government launched an online portal, the eBiz Mission Mode project, intended as a single window clearance for the Make in India mission. It brings the centre, the states and the local governments all onto one site. Till date, the portals got over 4,890 queries. They throw light on both investor interest in different industries and also what the manufacturers themselves expect from the government.
If it is just having clear policies and taking the decisions fast, the government has been really stalling their feet on a lot of these policies, at least with regards to the railway sector, I can talk. So we just need clarity and speed.
Electronics, electrical, textiles and food processing are the critical industries in the Make in India mission. All these ministries have sought more budget funds for special economic zones. Further, the government is also likely to announce or increase the 15% industry allowance incentive for small entrepreneurs.
For the projects to be funded by private parties, there should be an assured income for them, because nobody will give you for charity. Everybody wants return on the investment made. So ground rules should be set.
The Make in India program aims to project India as an investment and manufacturing destination. Since it was launched after the general budget last year, budget 2015-16 would be the first time the government will reveal how it plans to translate those aims into reality.
When Jaitley presents his next budget later this month, he will be riding on high hopes, especially on Make in India program. With camera person Narayan, Rajkamal Rao, Rajya Sabha TV.
Alright, on to international news. And all-night negotiations in Minsk have finally yielded a ceasefire agreement on the Ukraine crisis. A deal aimed at ending the fighting in eastern Ukraine could pave the way for a ceasefire that will come into effect from the 15th of February.
After 17 hours of marathon talks in Belarusian capital Minsk, Ukraine and Russia finally agreed to a peace roadmap. The all-night negotiation session involving leaders of Ukraine, Russia, France and Germany led to a ceasefire agreement that will be implemented on 15th of February. Under the agreement, heavy weapons will be pulled out from front lines and all prisoners will be released.
Это не самая лучшая ночь в моей жизни, но утро, на мой взгляд, доброе, потому что несмотря на все сложности переговорного процесса, нам все-таки удалось договориться о главном. Кстати говоря, почему так долго шли согласования, я думаю, это связано с тем, что, к сожалению, киевские власти до сих пор отказываются от прямых контактов с представителями.
Pro-Russian rebels have welcomed the deal. However, there are some key issues that remain to be settled. Ukraine will establish control of the international border by the end of the year. There's also no clarity on the status of the Baltsev, the railway hub in the east that's been the center of the fighting in recent days. All sides see the deal as a glimmer of hope. The outcome is also expected to influence decisions at an EU summit in Brussels on Thursday. The renewed commitment to respect Ukraine's sovereignty could reflect in a softer line towards Moscow. Bureau Report, Raj Sabha TV.
Meanwhile, Egypt has released two Al Jazeera journalists on bail after they served more than 400 days in prison. Accused of supporting the Muslim Brotherhood, Mohammed Fahmy and Bahir Mohammed still face court proceedings. The next hearing would be on the 23rd of February. This comes less than a fortnight after their colleague Peter Grest was reported to deported to Australia. The three journalists were first arrested in December 2013 on charges of helping terrorists and spreading false news and were sentenced to 7 years in jail. But this January, their convictions were quashed and their case was sent for a retrial. Meanwhile, US President Barack Obama has asked the Congress to formally authorize military force against the Islamic State. Obama said that the IS was going to lose and called on lawmakers to show a united front. However, he met swift resistance from Republicans as well as his fellow Democrats, wary of another war in the Middle East.
The fight against Islamic State could get bigger in coming days. US President Barack Obama has sent his long-awaited formal request to the Congress to authorize military force. The draft allows for certain ground combat operations, including hostage rescues and the use of special forces. It includes no geographic limitations on a possible extension of the war beyond Iraq and Syria.
This resolution reflects our core objective to destroy ISIL. It supports the comprehensive strategy that we've been pursuing with our allies and our partners. A systemic and sustained campaign of airstrikes against ISIL in Iraq and Syria, support and training for local forces on the ground, including the moderate Syrian opposition, preventing ISIL attacks in the region and beyond.
Obama sent his request to the Congress a day after his administration confirmed the death of aid worker Kayla Mueller, who was the last known American hostage held by the group. Both the Senate and the House of Representatives must now approve Obama's plan.
Now make no mistake, this is a difficult mission, and it will remain difficult for some time. It's going to take time to dislodge these terrorists, especially from urban areas. But our coalition is on the offensive. ISIL is on the defensive, and ISIL is going to lose.
The U.S. has carried out airstrikes against Islamic State since last year in a coalition with 60 other nations. The coalition includes two intergovernmental bodies, the European Union and the Arab League. But it is the first time a U.S. president has sought congressional approval to use military force since President George Bush in 2002 ahead of the invasion of Iraq. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And with that, time now to take a look at what's happening at the 35th National Games underway in Kerala. In the badminton mixed doubles round one event, host state Kerala has recorded a win over Chhattisgarh. Kerala's Arun Vishnu Shivarajan Revamma and Aparna Balan have defeated their Chhattisgarh counterpart Venkat Gaurav Prasad and Juhi Devangan 21-15, 21-19. West Bengal has won the gold medal in the 4 into 400 meters relay. Maharashtra has won the 110 meters men hurdle final event. Maharashtra's Siddhant Thingalaya completed his run in 13 minutes 83 seconds. Kerala won the second spot, followed by Tamil Nadu, and Telangana got the third spot. Kerala also made it to the 30 gold medals mark after Marita Mohan won the gold in women's cycling point race category. This is her third gold in the meet. Parvati and Bismi bagged the silver and bronze in the same category. And the Cricket World Cup opened today with a simple yet colourful ceremony at Christchurch in New Zealand. Children shared the stage with Maori warriors and dancers to entertain thousands of fans at Hagley Park. A booming fireworks display was also part of the biggest event that Christchurch is hosting ever since an earthquake devastated the city centre in February 2011. New Zealand and Australia are together hosting the event for the first time in 23 years. Their ceremony sets the stage for the 20th Cricket World Cup. 14 nations are taking part in this tournament. That's it for the moment. Thanks so much for joining us here on Rajya Sabha TV. Good night. We'll be right back.